So, I would like to introduce the next speaker today, Jean-Maria Vanacore, which is going to tell us about exploring the spatio-temporal dynamics of low-dimensional nanomaterials by ultra-fast electron microscopy. Jean-Maria got his bachelor master degree in science and master degree of science in physics engineering from the Politecnico di Milano. He was a PhD under the tutorship of the Politecnico di Milano, the École Polytechnique de Paris, and the French Atom Energy Commission. It was from 2011 to 2015, postdoctoral fellow in the group of the Nobel Prize Professor Zi Wei at the California Institute of Technology, and in 2016 was a senior scientist at the École Polytechnique Fédérale de Lausanne, Switzerland, in the group of Professor Carbone. And then since December 2019 is a researcher at the Department of Material Science of this university. And his research activity is dedicated to the investigation of ultrafast phenomena in nanoscale low-dimensional materials using ultrafast electron microscopy, which is the subject of his presentation today.
Thanks again for the nice introduction, Giancarlo, for the nice introduction to the microscopy platform, the Minersia Milano Bicocca. So in my presentation, I will try to discuss a little bit the activity, my research activity during the past 8 years, during my time at Caltech and EPFL. So also with some other perspectives that this research activity would entail in actually doing something together also here at the University of Milano Bicocca. So, let me start by I'm a physicist, but let me start going a little bit into the bio world. Let me take a leap into the bio world, and because I want to borrow a very interesting and very important concept that in biology is very important, is very present, and that's been the driving force of the research in the last probably 20 or 30 or even more years. So, which is actually the structure function paradigm. So basically, to understand basic molecular function, to understand basic molecular mechanisms, people have always tried to look at the structure of the biosystem. And so the idea is to understand structure to be able to understand function. And this is being the driving force behind the very exciting work in the last several years. For instance, I want to mention here the super resolution fluorescence microscopy, who was and actually the work behind this, the development of this technique brought to the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2014. Also, the very the so like the development of the cryo-electron microscopy, so which people were able to then see cells and proteins and down to the atomic level, was also brought to the Nobel Prize in Chemistry 2017. Also the work on molecular machine, which is actually the Nobel Prize in Chemistry 2016. So this has been the driving force, the structure function paradigm has been the driving force into the last 20 years of research in biology. And actually, what I want to say here is that actually that's not enough. Actually, to be able to properly understand what is the behavior of complex biosystems and generally complex systems, we need to modify the structure function paradigm, and to the modification stands in the integration of the fourth dimension, time. And so what I'm proposing you is the structure dynamics function paradigms, which then by the integration of time, one would be able to observe the transient behavior of materials. So for instance, this is very interesting. Here, you can see just a bunch of dots, a bunch of little dots. And while if you are looking at it statically, you will not be able to see what is the behavior, the complex behavior of this ensemble of dots. Paradigm. And the idea of studying things in motion has been one of the main one of the concepts in which actually people in science have always look at. And so for instance this the initial work on being able to see things in time, so like studying, investigating the dynamic behavior of complex systems, started from MyBridge, from its stop motion photography. And here the idea was to be able to see the exact position of the horse feet during the gallop phase of the horse motion. And so, and yeah, the idea is that actually, for instance, was able to decipher that all 4 feet of the horse are actually standing off the floor when the horse is when the horse is galloping. And this was done with a series of photographic machines. Then Marais in 1880 was actually able to use a shutter motion of a single camera with a shutter that was very fast to be able to see people to see a cat, for instance, falling. So it's a dynamic movement of a certain system. And then in the century introduced the concept of stroboscopy. So basically, you have now a series of flashes of light that allows for an object to be visible to a detector only for a limited time interval. So, for instance, you can see here a basketball bouncing up and down the floor. So this, when you, as you were saying, we were from the horse to a cat to a basketball. So lower and lower dimension of the system you are investigating means that you need to go faster and faster. In 1999, Ahmed Zibail was able to develop his femtochemistry. He was able to develop his femtochemistry camera. So he developed his femtochemistry camera, which is actually a pump probe scheme in which. An optical pump probe scheme in which he was able to see molecular reactions in real time. So now, the when you go from the molecules from molecules to the you want to go toward the nanostructure and the atoms. So you go from the optical microscope to an electron microscope, and while you go down in time. While you go down in time, also the time scale of the basic processes also changes in when you go down in space. I mean, also the temporal scale in which the different processes evolve also changes. So if you have like on the order of, for instance, microns or nanometers, we are talking about picoseconds, so 10 to minus 12 seconds. Then when we go to the atomic scale, we are talking about femtoseconds. And when we go to the electronic scale, so below the femtosecond, below the tenths of nanometers, then we are talking about attoseconds. And so what we need now is a technique that is able to investigate a certain phenomenon simultaneously in space and time with the appropriate resolutions, both temporal and spatial resolution. And this is actually the idea behind what is an ultra-fast electron, behind ultra-fast electron microscopy. And this is actually the let's say a basic scheme of an ultrafast electron microscope. So an ultrafast electron microscope is a modified transmission electron microscope with two optical axes. So now there is actually a laser that is coupled to the microscope, and one will use the spatial resolution of a TEM and temporal resolution of a femtocycle laser to obtain an instrument that will be able to give you will be able to give you the temporal and spatial visualization of processes in spatial visualization of processes in real time, so their temporal evolution. So basically, just to be really quick, so this femtosecond laser that is used to generate photoelectrons from the source. So here you will have like bunches of electrons that then interact with the sample. After, a laser pulse is used to excite the sample from a ground state to an excited state. And now the detection system is actually works like in a normal microscope. And so one would be able to do time resolve diffraction, time resolve spectroscopy with the so like the spatial momentum and energy resolution of a TEM, but with the temporal resolution of a femtosecond laser. So to go back to stay within to stay within the biology side, in 2010, Professor Zwille, he proposed this Gedanken experiment in which you have a protein that is contained in glassy ice, so like the starting condition of a cryo-EM study. And now a laser pulse will actually melt the ice around the region of the protein. The protein will fold or unfold, will actually dynamically change its conformation, and now the ice will refreeze, and now you start again the cycle. Because remember, we are talking about a stroboscopic way of a stroboscopic process of investigation. So now this was, of course, again like an experiment. A few years later, together with a couple of collaborators at Caltech, we actually try to do this experiment in a real laboratory setting. So basically, now we took some amyloid fibers into a glassy ice, and now we studied actually the diffraction, and we studied the temporal behavior of the electron diffraction from this amyloid fiber in a glassy ice. And what we were looking at was the distance between the beta sheets and the evolution between the beta sheets, one using a clock impulse that would be able to locally melt the ice and leave the protein be able to evolve. And so basically, this is what we see is that when we have no ice around, the protein is very stiff. So the beta sheets are attached quite strongly one to the other, but then when you are in glassy ice, the hydrogen bonding with the beta sheets make the bonding between the different beta sheets less strong, and so actually being able to expand more when the clock impulse, the clocking light pulse arrives. So this was, let's say, the first example of time resolved cryo-electron diffraction. So now to go back at what actually it's more my background and my line of research. So basically materials, quantum materials, low-dimensional materials. So one of the important thing that what we are seeing in the last few years is actually this much of the research in condensed matter physics is going toward the investigation of quantum systems. And now what quantum means is actually a bit controversial, although what I would say is actually a quantum system is characterized by the unique electronic and structural properties that results from the spatial confinement, so means low dimensionality, like 2D confinement, 1D confinement, 0D confinement, correlations among the different degrees of freedom, and of course also topological projection. Now, when using light, one would be able to shift this balance among the different degrees of freedom of the system, providing a very interesting way to manipulate the material properties. And so this is actually one direction in which ultrafast electron microscopy can give a real answer that can be really, really important. For instance, and to do that, one has also needs to be able to investigate the different excitations within a material with the proper sensitivity, which is not only spatial resolution but also energy resolutions and also momentum. So together with the temporal resolution, different excitations, accessing all these different dimensionalities within your system, which is space, time, momentum, energy, is actually will be able to distinguish among all the different excitations and investigate all kinds of phenomena. Okay. So as a first example, I want to go back to one of the work I did when I was at Caltech, actually with in collaboration with Professor Stefano Sanguinetti here from the Material Science Department. And what we studied was the gallium arsenide boson, aluminum gallium arsenide, and we studied quantum dots with different dimensions, from a very small dimension in which you have strong electron and photon confinement to a very large dimension in which you have basically a bulk-like behavior. And so here you change the confinement, the spatial confinement of electrons and also phonons. So not only electrons, but also like atomic vibrations. And so what we started diffraction. We did an ultra-fast electron diffraction experiment. And so you have here an electron pulse that is able to probe the system, and a laser pulse that is able to excite the system. So what we excite the system from a ground state to an excited state, for instance, in this case, exciting atomic vibration within the quantum dot. And then we probe this behavior as a function of the time by changing the delay time between these two guys, between the laser pump and the electron probe. And so what we see is basically a movie of how the diffraction pattern evolves in time while as a function of this delay time after the initial laser pulse arrives on the sample. And so basically what we have is something like this, in which you have intensity as a function of time, in which you have a certain dynamic behavior, which can be directly correlated, because we are talking about an intensity of a Bragg peak, directly correlated to the displacement of the atoms within the system. And so from all this diffraction pattern, what we were able to see, we were able to construct a map of the temporal behavior of the quantum dot. So basically what we are able to see that this atomic vibration, what we are seeing here is the temporal is the time needed for this atomic motion to start. Basically, okay? So what we see here that we have a pretty fast dynamics on the few picosecond time scale, which is pretty homogeneous around the whole quantum dot. And so this is indicative of a process of decay from the optical phonons to some high energy acoustic phonons that then they are traveling unperturbed within the dot. So what we are seeing here is an effect of ballistic phonon transport within the dot, which is consistent with the fact that the size of this dot is smaller than the inelastic phonon mean prepuff of the acoustic phonons in gallium arsenide. In the larger dot, the situation changed. The larger dot, we are seeing that a stronger relaxation not toward the low energy form. So basically, what we are doing is like we're exciting very low energy, long wavelength acoustic phonons, which is basically we are heating up the system. So that means that you have lots of scattering and basically a diffusive transport. And this different nature of the transport of funnels into quantum dots is also evidenced by the presence of coherent lattice vibrations when you have a coherent ballistic transport, or basically no vibrations at all when there is a diffusive transport. So now we were in zero D dimensions, so we also did something in 2D dimensions, so basically with graphene. And one of the first things that I learned when I started to study is that actually graphene should exist. I mean, theoretically speaking, ideally speaking, let's say, graphene is not stable. If you have a perfect perfectly flat graphene layer, in the harmonic approximation, the long wavelength fluctuations will destroy such a perfect two-dimensional lattice. And this is very, you can see this from, for instance, here I'm quoting the Landau-Lifshitz statistical physics book, but also like Piles, also Mermin, they were discussing this. So, and that's why, for instance, for many years, physicists believed that graphene could not be isolated. A single layer of graphene could not be isolated. Actually, graphene is stable and was isolated by Game and Novoselov. And this is because the stability of graphene is actually directly correlated to out-of-plane corrugations, so basically ripples, that are mediated by out-of-plane phonons, so these ZA phonons. And the presence of these ripples is actually this three-dimensional bending is always responsible for an enhanced scattering of charge carriers. So one way to improve carrier mobility would be actually to decrease such rippling structure in graphene. So we actually try to investigate this rippling state and this rippling dynamics by doing a diffraction experiment on a single layer of graphene. We did so. The experiment is always the same. Pulse that excites a phonon distribution excites the system, and then the electron pulse that is probing it. So what we see is that basically monitor the anharmonic decay of phonons, and we can monitor this as a function of the excitation fluents. The interesting thing, so here, for instance, we are basically seeing the fact that the electron, the laser excitation is able to excite electron carriers, these charge carriers. They couple to optical phonons, and these optical phonons couple to acoustic phonons. So this is an harmonic phonon decay, evolve on different time scales according to their dynamics. And so this was everything well calculated also theoretically, and the calculations were very close to the experimental values in which one would consider these three phonon processes, basically, in which you have a decay toward from high energy to low energy phonons. The interesting thing that I want to mention here is that what we were able to see, the lattice, quite peculiar behavior of the lattice. So basically, we were seeing a mean plane expansion on after just a few picoseconds, and then a strong out of plane, strong in plane contraction. So now the contraction is actually determined by the excitation of out-of-plane ZA phonons on a long time scale, but the contraction, the in-plane expansion, is actually determined by the fact that you, at the short time scale, you only have longitudinal and transverse acoustic phonons in the graphene plane, and the ZA phonons are not excited yet. So the picture that is coming up is that when you have only, after a few picoseconds, only the transverse and longitudinal acoustic phonons are excited, you have this in-plane expansion that is able to stretch the graphene lattice, and then only on a longer time scale, then you have the ZA phonons that are excited, and now the rippling structure comes back. And so one possible application of this that we were suggesting in the paper is to use the process as a ultra-fast switch, ultra-fast electrical switch. So basically, we calculated that with the in-plane expansion that we generate using our femtocycle laser, we could have like several orders of magnitude change in the resistivity for the graphene. Okay, so now let me go a little bit into what is even more my research during the last few years at EPFL, and to what we have been studying is like more toward the basic quantum interaction between electron and light, light being both polaritons, so like localized electromagnetic field. And because this actually goes into the direction of the ability to coherently manipulate electrons using light. Now, this is actually the basic thing behind the dynamical investigation of materials, but also, for instance, coherent manipulation of electrons by light is the basic ingredient for free electron lasers, and is one of the basic ingredients for then being able to access some hidden phases of matter, of quantum materials, and this so it's actually gets extremely powerful here. One other thing that I want to say is that one of the way, if you just imagined to have electrons and light interacting in free space, this actually cannot occur. And when I say interact, I mean a complete absorption of an electron, of a complete absorption of a photon from an electron. In this case, you cannot conserve in free space both energy and momentum. So one way to overcome this issue is actually to create some localized near field. Now, in the creation of this localized near field, there are additional momentum components that would allow the momentum conservation to be fulfilled. And now, actually, the electron can can absorb a photon, or can give to the electromagnetic field energy to put one more photon into the field. And so this is actually what was seen experimentally in an experiment in which you have a laser that excites a near field around a nanostructure. Now, what you have that now the interaction of this electron with the near field will create in an electron energy spectrum a series of peaks and multiples of the photon energy. So now here you will have a peak for an electron that has gained the one photon that is absorbed one photon, is absorbed two photon or three photon. And here, those are the electrons that have lost the energy associated to one photon, to two photon or three photons. So this is what is generally called photon-induced near-field electron microscopy. What we saw is that actually you don't only need a near-field structure, even just the presence of a mirror for light that will be able to break the translational symmetry of the light of the electromagnetic field, then this will be able to create those additional momentum components to fulfill the momentum conservation. So we demonstrated this experimentally, and so we were able to actually make a pretty complete picture of this process that is generally called as inverse transition radiation, and we characterize this on the ultrafast electron microscope. The interesting thing is now that in the microscope we're able to not only see the energy exchange, but if we go to the so-called high dispersion HDD mode, high dispersion diffraction mode, we are also able to look at the momentum changes induced by the light field on the electron beam. So what you can see here, for instance, is the Gaussian profile of an electron beam in the Fourier plane, and its distribution actually represents the lateral coherence of the beam. So now when the beam interacts with a light field, with this semi-infinite light field, is able to get stretched along one direction. And this direction is the momentum of light. So basically what's happening here is that the light is streaking in momentum the electron beam. not only it's tricking the momentum in electron beam, but also in energy. So if we actually create a space, sorry, a momentum energy map, what we get is that actually this streaking profile in which we can see directly how the electron wave function, how the wave function of this free electron that is interacting with light gets tricked into this, gets modified into this phase space. And the slope of this linear streaking here is actually proportional to the speed of light. So if you want, this is a quite complicated way to measure the speed of light. But what is actually even more interesting is that now what we are seeing here is that we are able to split the electron into a series of quantum states, each characterized by a certain energy and a certain momentum. And now what we wanted to understand is actually how coherent are these states. And we use so a two-pulse scheme, a double pulse interaction in which we have two light pulses interacting with a single electron pulse. The two light pulses were coherent with each other and were coherent with each other. So then the relative coherence, the relative phase shift was we were able to change the relative phase shift by changing the relative delay time. And so what we did is actually this. We were getting the laser to interact with a single electron interacting with a single laser pulse, and that was creating, so the first interaction between the electron and the first laser pulse was creating this this energy momentum redistribution of the electron wave function. Now, the interaction with the second laser pulse was able to create the was able to either enhance this momentum energy momentum splitting or to either enhance or to suppress this variation. And so here we can see exactly this in this energy loss spectrum measured as a function of the delay time between the two pulses. So and this variation is actually this periodicity is the given by the optical cycle of the light. And because we are using light at 800 nanometers, so we are optical cycle is 2.6 femtosecond. So basically we were able to modulate the electron wave function with a periodicity given by the light. So basically only just a few femtoseconds. So this is actually the what was the concept of modifying the longitudinal phase of an electron pulse in just like a few femtoseconds using light. This is actually all pedantic to the ability to investigate, for instance, localized electromagnetic excitation evolving in time. With this method that we were developed in Lausanne that we called electron holography or even quantum electron holography. So just to clarify couple of concepts, these plasmon polaritons are defined as the coupling between plasmons, which are collective oscillation of charges at an interface, and a polariton, so which is basically an evanescently confined near field. So now several techniques can be able to see polaritons, but they all need to have this in common. So they need to have a nanometer spatial resolution, a femtosecond to picosecond temporal resolution, and an energy resolution in the order of dB. So our technique is able to do that. And in fact, if you collect all electrons that have gained energy to form an image, now you will be able to visualize the near field created a nanostructure by the laser radiation. So for instance, here you can see the dipolar field created by a light field around the spherical nanostructures. So this is the case, for instance, of a nanowire, in which here you can see the presence of a Fabry-Perot resonances in a nanowire. And this is a graphene strip. And here you can see the plasmonic, the near field created around the edge of a plasmonic, of a graphene strip. This is actually all done using this ultrafast electron microscopy, or actually the spinning method in ultrafast electron microscopy. But these are all stationary fields, so they don't evolve in time. A surface plasmon polaritons propagating on a waveguide does, and so we actually developed a modified method to be able to see such a propagation. For instance, imagine that you have here an edge, and now the light field will be able to launch an SPP along the surface of the sample. So a surface plasmon polariton along the surface of the sample. Now a single electron pulse that will travel through the material will actually integrate over all over the propagation of the plasmon polariton. But now what we use a different we use another plasmon polariton that will be able to interfere with the first one as excited by an additional laser pulse. And now what we'll be able to see here is an interference pattern created by the two. And now we can see the evolution of the two plasmon. So basically it's some kind of holography process in which one pulse will behave as the reference, and the other pulse will behave as the unknown signal. And so this is the case that I was describing in real space. This is a movie of the evolution, and now you see that you have this fringe contrast that will appear here in the bottom of the image, and now we slowly move toward the top of the quadrant here. And this is also clear in this image on the right. Here, this is a movie, it's a slightly longer movie in which you can see the presence of the fringe pattern, that this interference pattern that will actually appear first at the bottom left of this quadrant, and then slowly work its way up toward the center. And then toward the top of the, now we are basically the entire quadrant, and now we will actually go mostly on the top right part of this quadrant. And now if you actually retrieve this as a function of time, one can see you have actually interference pattern that goes from the bottom to the entire quadrant to the only top part of this quadrant. And so now if you measure, if you plot this fringe pattern as a function of time, you will be able to get information on the phase velocity, on the group velocity of the plasmon, which is very both are actually for instance, for the here I'm reporting the group velocity, which is actually quite in agreement with the theoretical values. So this is actually a possible way to a possible way to understand the behavior, the dynamical behavior of a localized excitation within the material. Another possible way is actually to use a combination of the process that I was describing before with a semi-infinite field in some kind of Ramsey type electron holography approach, in which you have the electron pulse that would be first modulated in energy, will modulate it, so we will modulate it in phase by a first light pulse, and then this electron, which is modulated in phase, will actually interact with an SPP field in this case, or for instance, the excitation that one wants to study. And because the initial modulation of the electron and the excitation of the SPP in this case, or the excitation of the certain process, are made with the same laser or with this laser that are in correlated in phase, then the electron will be only selective, only sensitive to this excitation. So we will actually be able to construct an hologram. So basically, we'll be able to construct a we'll be able to visualize within the sample only the excitation that we are going to drive. So Because generally the problem here is that an electron will be able to interact with many of the processes that are going on. And most likely the real deal is actually to distinguish among the different local excitations. So to make the electron a very sensitive probe to a certain specific excitation, we use this Ramsey scheme in which the electron will be modulated in phase by the same laser, by the same light pulse that would be then responsible for the excitation of the localized localized process in the sample. And so this is just like an initial experimental observation along this line. And for instance, I think this process will be very interesting to investigate the purity of a certain excitation. So now imagine that you have a certain excitation inside your sample that is in a pure state. So is fully coherent, or is in a mixed state, which is fully incoherent. So now, the fully incoherent, you have a diagonal density matrix. In a pure state, you have a coupled density matrix. Now, these two different density matrices will give different spectrograms, different holograms. And so, in this way, using this Ramsey-like holographic method, one can actually get specific information about the quantum coherent state of a specific excitation inside your sample. And the last part, and then I know that I'm running a bit long, but the last part is actually on the creation of chiral plasmons and on the ability to transfer orbital angular momentum from a chiral plasmon to an electron beam. And so, for instance, now we have seen before the fact that if you have a little edge, if you have a ridge, you can have the presence of a near field. And now, when the near field is created at the interface between a metal and a dielectric, so here a silver layer and a silicon nitride layer, there is a plasmon that gets launched. So in the previous case, we had a rectangular ridge, a rectangular cavity. And from this rectangular cavity, we were able to excite plane wave plasmons. Now, if your nano cavity is a hole on the whose size is actually on the order of the wavelength, and you're using circularly polarized light, then what happens is that you create a chiral plasmon. So basically a plasmon that carries the angular momentum. And so this is, okay, the way in which we image this is using the beam holography method that I described before. The interesting thing is that, for instance, if you look at the phase of the local field created by this chiral plasmon, this is actually what you get, and at the center of the hole there is a vortex. A vortex is a stagnant point in which the field is exactly zero and the phase is undefined. But then if you take a contour along this vortex, a contour line along this vortex, you immediately realize that along this contour the phase changes from zero to 2 pi, or from minus pi to pi, and so basically. And this determines the azimuthal order of the vortex, which is also called topological charge of the vortex. And the azimuthal order of the vortex is an indication of the orbital angular momentum contact, which is within this electromagnetic field. So now, with light, you are able to excite such a field, which is this chiral plasmon. So now, what happens? This is like a fulcrization with the PNEM technique of these chiral plasmons. So now, the interesting thing is that, let's imagine what happens to an electron plane wave. So now you have an electron wave that is actually a plane wave that goes through a region in which there is such a phase distribution, such a vortex phase distribution. So now if you put down a couple of equations, you immediately realize that this the wave function Psi0 will transform into a wave function Pl that will actually be represented by, be described using this phase vector, exponential by L m phi. This is a coarse true phase vector in which depends on the azimuthal angle phi, on the number of, on this m, which is the azimuthal order of the carrier plasmon, in our case is one, and by L, which is actually the number of absorbed or emitted plasmons. So the presence of this coarse true phase vector makes this wave function Pl an eigenvalue of the orbital angular momentum operator with an eigenfunction, sorry, of the angular momentum operator with eigenvalues equal to Lm h bar. So basically, you start with an electron plane wave, and after the interaction with this chiral plasmon, you end up with a vortex electron wave, and this vortex electron wave will have an orbital angular momentum given by Lm h bar, so determined by how many plasmons the electron has absorbed or emitted, and what is the order of the chiral plasma. And we proved this. This is some just theory used using this equation. With this, looking at the momentum distribution of the electron beam. So, in when you have a plane wave, the electron the momentum distribution is a Gaussian. So, this is actually what we measured. Then, when you have a vortex beam, but the electron distribution, because you have a zero in the middle, it becomes a donut. It becomes this donut shape structure, which is actually what we measure. And now we also did a control experiment in which you use a linear polarization instead of a circular polarization for the incident light. What you get here is you don't get a vortex anymore, but like now you get a plate with two different faces from one side to the other, so in which now you don't have a point, but you have you don't have only a singularity in the middle. You have an entire line of singularities, and so what you create is you split basically into the electron beam, and this is what we also measured. The interesting thing is that now we can use this double pass scheme that we also used before to quickly change the polarization of the light, and so quickly change the emissivity of the chiral plasma. And so this is exactly what we are showing here in this movie, in which images are taken with like, I think, 300 frames, one after the other. And so what we see is that in about 1.3 femtosecond, the chiral plasma doesn't change from clockwise to counterclockwise rotation. And so this is what I'm reporting here. Okay, so you can see that you have the initial clockwise rotation changes to a counterclockwise rotation after about 1.3 femtoseconds. So the and you're able to do this back and forth many times according to the cycles of the optical pulse. And so this is basically it. To go back at what I started. So I started talking about biomaterials, and so I finished talking about biomaterials. I'm describing here, I'm showing you here the application of the PNEM imaging, so this near field electron microscopy imaging on biosystems. So this is the image of a bright field image of an E. coli cell, and this is the PNEM image of an E. coli cell. So basically, the near field that is very localized at the edges and is able to make the to induce a higher contrast with a higher spatial resolution image of a cell membrane, and also one can be able to see the evolution of processes that are on the order of hundreds of femtoseconds while studying this protein. So I try to show you like how ultrafast electron microscopy can really become a very interesting tool for studying fundamental dynamic evolution of nanomaterials. I showed you a couple of examples for nanosystems, low-dimensional nanosystems like the quantum dots or graphene. in which there is always this, we were able to unravel the coupling between electronic and atomic degrees of freedom. And also I showed you like the coherent manipulation of localized electromagnetic fields, such as surface plasmon polaritons, would allow to be a very exciting tool for coherent phase shaping of the electron wave function on a sub-femtosecond time scale. So these are the many people to thank for all this work. Of course, all the people at EDPFL, Caltech, and all the other collaborators all around the world, from Spain to Canada, to Politecnico Milano, to Technion, to CNR in Modena. And of course, I thank you for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Gian Maria. I think now there should be some questions. So if you have questions, just raise up your hand. I will try to make you as a panelist. In this way, you can be heard from by Gian Maria. Angelina, you can speak now.
Hi, it's Angelina Comotti speaking. I would like to ask you if you can study also single crystals, about especially the dynamical evolution, the first part.
Oh yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Actually, it will be easier studying single crystals because you don't need to push your spatial resolution. But absolutely, the single crystals, the quantum dots, for instance, the gallium arsenide quantum dots from Stefano Sanguinetti, they were single crystals. So actually, single crystals make your life easier, absolutely.
And the crystalline powders instead?
Also, I think it's you can, of course, in crystalline powders, you're going to deal with not single spots, but with like the bi-Waller, the bi-shear rings. So this will actually, I will not say complicate, but it will actually limit a little bit the information that you can get because you're going to have an average around the momentum space. But of course, it's actually possible to, it's definitely possible to study also that.
Absolutely. Thank you.
We have done several work on, you're welcome.
Martin, try to speak.
Ah, yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Great. Yes.
All right. I have a question concerning the vortex beam. And there you showed the simulation of this TD phase, like one of the last slides.
Yeah, the FDTD simulation, finite difference time domain simulations, yes.
Exactly, and there you were showing that there's a vortex beam by showing that the phase in the middle is not defined or in the infinite.
Yes.
Was it the phase of the electric field or of the wave?
Yes, it's the phase of the electric field. And it's actually, I'll tell you more, it's the phase of the out of plane component of the electric field, so the one that is sticking out of the two-dimensional plane, and this is because the electrons that are interacting with the plasmon field, they mainly interact with the Z component, so this the component of the electric field along the propagation direction of the electron beam itself. So this is actually what matters in this electron localized field interaction. No? It's this electric field, this EZ component. And so what we mapped, we retrieved from this simulation the phase of the EZ component of the field, of the electric field.
Ah, very interesting. And do you have like the proof that that is really an that the electron beam is a vortex field, you show the intensity, or do you also have some kind of phase of the electron wave front, or you show this?
So the proof is actually the momentum distribution. In the momentum distribution, we were able to see the donut shape of the momentum profile, of the transverse momentum profile, which is actually the fingerprint of the presence of a vortex. Because if you have a vortex, you have a zero in the middle, and so you get a donut. While when you don't have this, there is only the it's a Gaussian because you have like a normal plane wave, or we also did the control experiment with the linear polarization, not with the circular polarization. So now the linear polarization will divide your inside of your hole into a two parts phase plate. In one half you will have only pi phase, in the other half you will have only minus pi phase, so the beam will be split in two. You will not have you will not have a donut. Will be split in two, and this is also what we saw. The like beam splitted in two into the after the interaction with a linear plasmon field.
Okay, thank you so far. Very interesting. I've got one more question from the FDD's relation. Like this was a slice in the XY plane, I guess, and. Was it between the metal and the electric, or?
Yes, it's at the interface between the metal and the electric. And because we saw that when you create a hole into the metallic part, you end up exciting both plasmons, both in the interface between the metal and the electric, and also at the interface between the metal and air. The thing is actually the electron couple with a much higher cross section with the electron at the interface, because between the metal and the dielectric, because there you have a larger change of the. You have a larger change of the refractive index between the two materials. And so you can actually have a larger cross section in interaction with the electrons. So we are basically sensitive to that field, the one that is at the interface between the silver and the dielectric, and the silicon nitride.
Okay, yeah, very interesting. So I've got one more question, sorry. The actual vortex beam. Is it only like the pinum, like only electrons which got energy transferred, that those are a vortex beam, or is it the total? Like only.
Indeed. It's only the. It's only the ones that have transfer energy. It's an inelastic process, absolutely. You're right. So to have a momentum that is different from zero, an orbital angular momentum different from zero, you need to either absorb or create a plasmon. If the electrons are elastically scattered, so they don't exchange anything with them, then you end up with a zero net angular momentum.
All right. Thank you very much, Stefan.
Thank you.
Any other question? In that case, I have a question.
Yes.
So I would like to know if you know about any application to mineral sciences, for instance, for the study of phase transition.
Well, actually, no. Actually, for the phase transition, it actually would be very interesting. There is a caveat, though. I mean, if you do diffraction and you measure the diffraction as a function of time after the initial laser pulse arrives, so basically, the initial laser pulse gives you the trigger for the phase transition. Which can be an electronic trigger, so basically because you are the electronic population in your system gets excited and you have an electronic driven phase transition, or just because you are thermally heating your system using light. And then you can follow with the electrons how the especially in diffraction, but also you could do, and this is something actually I would like to do, you could do like a dark field imaging. So you sit on a certain diffraction spot and you measure and you do also the image, so you also have information about where your diffraction, your new phase is evolving. You can definitely do that. One thing is that what I showed you in these measurements is basically everything based on a stroboscopic measurement. Stroboscopic means that after each pulse, the system has to go back to equilibrium. So after the laser pulse arrives and before the next laser pulse comes, the system has to go back to equilibrium. So you need a reversible phase transition. Of course, you can do also single shot measurements. Single shot measurements will actually allow you to study irreversible phase transition. The only caveat is that with the single shot measurements, you cannot reiterate the process for many, many times like you do with stroboscopic. And so with stroboscopy, you can allow yourself to go with a single electron pulse that will preserve your temporal resolution, but and will not perturb the signal to noise ratio because you can integrate for millions and millions of events. In the case of a single shot, you have only one pulse, one shot, so you need to go there with lots of electrons to have an acceptable level of signal to noise ratio, which of course will perturb the resolution. So generally, single shot measurements are in the range of picosecond or even nanosecond timescales. But it's actually what you want to do. It's but definitely phase transitions, crystallographic phase transitions, even either electron driven or thermally driven, can be definitely studied.
Okay, thank you. So in this case, we have to plan some experiments together.
Absolutely, it would be a pleasure.
Any other question? If you have question, please raise up your hand. I will see. And I give you the possibility to speak. So, if there are no more questions, I think we can say thank you to all participants. And we will keep you informed about the next conference. As you probably know, the next conference which was planned for the next Friday is cancelled for some problems, and then we are going to plan that conference in the future. I will keep you informed when will be organized. If there are no more questions, just say thank you everybody, bye bye.
Thank you all for coming. Thank you Giancarlo for hosting.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.